you don't need to force things in big wave surfing. Big wave surfing is like a marathon. It's not a race. You know, the more older you get, the more experience. And experience is priceless. And, you know, I learn every session something. And now I go there thinking I don't know shit. When I was 20, I went there telling I know everything. Now it all changed. And I think it's just maturity is natural for the human being, especially men.
Hi, and welcome or welcome back to the Mindset and Performance Podcast. I'm Driss, a mindset and performance coach. I help athletes and young professionals with their career development. We work on a wide range of areas, from training to nutrition, but focus essentially on the mindset as it is the key to everything else. The whole idea behind this podcast is to deconstruct the habits that led people to their success, to learn from their experience and understand the psychology behind their actions and behavior, and of course, to know what kind of mindsets they have. This week's podcast interview is with Othman Choufani, a Moroccan big wave surfer. Othman is only 26 years old, but has already a lot of great experience surfing and traveling all around the world. During this interview, Othman shares with us the story of his relationship with surfing. His journey started at a very young age in the city of Agadir, which is considered the capital of surfing in North Africa. Othman's teenage years were full of adventure around the small town of Tarazout, where he grew up looking up and learning from his peers. Othman started surfing at the age of 9 years old in Morocco, then moved to France when he was 15 to train with Philippe Malvaux and Michel Plateau at the Pôle France Surf. He quit competition contests when he was 18 years old and started traveling the world looking for big waves. He now spends most of his time between Morocco, Europe, Mexico, Indonesia, California, and Hawaii. The charger has been challenging big waves since a very young age. He is actually considered the pioneer in this category of surfing. Othman is the first Moroccan surfer that started exploring the massive swells both in Morocco and all around the world. In this conversation, you can learn that talent doesn't mean much if you don't put the necessary work to get better. Othman also tells us about his training drills and how he combines physical and mental preparation to deal with pressure and challenging situations. Othman earned his nickname because of his warm, loving, and bubbly personality. He is a very passionate person, and you can clearly hear that from the sound of this discussion. So I hope you enjoy my conversation with Othman, and feel free to share your comments and questions. We are already recording, by the way, but this is awesome. Finally meeting up. You're a hard fish to catch.
Just play it hard.
You just did it in purpose.
I'd rather do it in real life because I don't know the emotions and the stuff. Like on the phone, sometimes you just get disturbed, you know. And I want it to be really real and honest, you know. So
yeah, that's where I'm looking
forward
to.
On it.
Yeah. Yeah, so I wanted to catch up with you here to talk about everything.
Yeah.
Everything. Because, you know, we meet one time a year, I think.
Yeah.
Since some time now. But there was a whole period where I completely missed what was happening. Mm. So we met when, I think 10 years ago, when you were around 12, 13.
Yeah, I was 12 years old.
12 years old.
12 or 13.
So what was that, like 2006, 2005?
Yeah, I'm 26
even?
Now, so
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then there was a big gap there, something that I missed. Mm. And I'd like to talk about that, to talk about your parkour, what brought you to where you are at today, because I think a lot of people would learn from it. As you know, I work with young athletes. And sometimes there's a little link missing, and I'm hoping that you're going to connect the dots between making it happen and trying to make it happen.
Definitely.
So I'm sure there will be a lot of insight there.
So when I first met you, I was in school in Morocco. So I was just surfing on Wednesdays and on weekends.
Yeah.
And it's just what makes me the happiest, you know, surfing. That's what I've been like loving the most, you know. I did theater, like acting when I was a kid. I did soccer, but then when I started surfing, I couldn't stop. Mm. And I was like doing my homework every time, like very good after a good session. But if I didn't surf for a bit, I was like very I needed it. I really needed my surf fix, you know. So as an...
You were competing also then, right?
Yeah, I was competing in like normal contest, mm-hmm. and I never really enjoyed it, but I was good enough to compete, and I was just having fun with my friend, you know. That's how I saw it. But I always wanted to do good, you know. Nobody wanted to do bad. Mm. But when I lost, I was just happy to go back out and surf. Mm. So I really realized at a young age that that's what makes me happy, and I wanted to be happy. Mm. But then at 15 years old, I had to go to high school, and high school in Morocco is like, the French high school is like 8 to 6 from Monday to Friday. And
super I was like, packed, yeah, busy.
Packed, yeah. Busy, no time for sport, like super like, shitty stuff, you know. Mm. No sport, no time for myself, and I was like, this is gonna make me very like, I'm gonna regret it all my life. So I start to message the French team and the French Federation to ask them if it was possible to go to boarding school in France and be trained by the French Federation. And I just did it myself without telling my parents, without telling my friend.
They didn't know
unless it was sure. And I had a meeting with them. So I came at 14 years old, actually, to my parents. I was like, I need to talk with you. And they're like, okay. And I was like, okay, I want to go to France to boarding school. My dad was like, no, because my dad went to boarding school. And he's like, I don't want my son to leave this. Like, in Europe, it's cold. I don't want you to live the same thing. I was like, hey, but this is my choice. My dad went to boarding school. It wasn't his choice. So then my mom really worked hard to let him let me go, but it was, they always respected my choice, you know. But I didn't know that they had like this kind of little fight between like, should I stay or should I go, you know.
They argued between the two of them.
They didn't really argue, but like my dad was just like, he was just scared, and my mom was like, let worst case scenario, go for the meeting, check the school, check with the French team, and then you'll see it yourself. So me and my dad took the car, and then we drove to France with all my boards.
All the way from Morocco?
Yeah, because I had a world championship in Portugal. So we went to France to meet the French team. And then I had a meeting with the school people, like all the director, some teachers, and they saw me, and I talked with them. It was a big round table, and my dad just was like impressed the way I talk. Like, I knew how to talk when I wanted something, you know. So, and then I was good at school too. So they were like, okay, no worries. If there's 16 spot, if we fill 16, it's not possible. But if we fill 15, you'll take the last spot. They feel like they took 13 kids, so I was all right. Then we just went to the French embassy back home to ask for my visa. It was weird. They never seen that, you know, student visa for a minor, like under 18. And everything worked out, and I knew it. And then I went to France, and I just started this new life, you know, start training with the best French surfer.
You knew what to expect? Like, have you been to France before?
Yeah, I was going to France every summer. I knew everybody already.
I had my sponsor
there. Oh. So I kind of like... I knew what I was
second home, kind of.
Yeah, I knew I was going to leave. I knew winter were hard, but you know, I surfed every day, and I was going to school, and I had a normal education, and that was my parents' goal, like to for me to finish at least high school. And I always tell them, yeah, I want to finish high school, and I was always like, yeah, but you know, pro surfing, I'm not sure about that. I just want to surf, you know, and so I can do good at school. But in my head, fuck. I just wanted to be a pro surfer since the beginning, but I never told them it was my own goal. I never told anyone. Mm-hmm. You know, I just worked hard to make it happen and didn't tell anyone unless, like, you know, it really happened. And then my goal was always just to be able to surf for the rest of my life. So if you want to surf for the rest of your life and surf the best wave, you have to be a pro surfer, obviously. Or move to Bali.
Yeah.
And
Who was inspiring you back then? Did you have an inspiration, or like who was in the back of your head when you were envisioning your future as a pro surfer and everything?
Just the
were you looking up to someone?
Yeah, just the kid my age just the best kid of my age that were doing trees, we're going to Oz, we're going to training camp. I was just like, yeah, like this is what I want to do. They inspire me, so I was just doing it myself. And I realized that I was doing visualization since I'm 14 or something like that. I always see
without
myself.
Without knowing exactly what the term, right?
Yeah, yeah, I didn't know what it was, but every night I was imagining myself with a team and like being on a surf trip with like being young pro surfer, you know? And then I was imagining myself very deep, like with a brand like Rip Curl, and then I got sponsored by Rip Curl. And then I was like, okay, so this is... it works. So I start to imagine myself doing this and this, and it worked. And
cool. Would you mind if we go a little bit backward to the first chapters? like even before or maybe in the beginning of the surfing journey? When did you start, actually? How old were you when you started?
I learned how to swim when I was like 2 years old, I think.
2 years old?
Yeah. Like, so I was swimming by myself at 2 years old. At 2.5 years old, 3, I was stealing my mom's bodyboard at the beach. Yeah. And at 4, I was standing up on my mom's bodyboard. Every time we go to the beach, there was nothing else to do in Agadir.
Papa and mama was surfing? Or
Papa
they were into
used to surf.
Used to surf.
And I used to surf a bit, but he was always hanging at the beach, like with his friends. And my mom used to bodyboard, and she was always friends with surfers. So,
would you say it's normal that if you grow up by the beach, you turn to be a surfer?
It should be normal, but it's not.
Not always the case,
no,
right?
No. I was connected to the ocean. I feel better in the ocean.
Yeah.
But then from 4 to 9, I was just surfing, like having fun at the beach. And then at 9, I got my first surfboard, 9 or 10. And then I just never quit. You know, never, like that was my thing.
And how did you know that you were quite good at it? And when?
It was very hard because my best friend is one of the best surfers in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I was competing with him. I always lost, and he was always like way better than me. But when I go to France, he was doing first. I was doing second.
Mm-hmm.
So at a like international scale, I wasn't that bad. Mm-hmm. But he was like next level.
Mm-hmm.
So he just took me with him. You know, I was just like, okay, this is the guy to beat. So I just have the best example and one of the best guy to grow up with, Ramsey, to surf with. So I was just like, all right, like, he's very, very good, but I'm not bad either. And now he's one of the best in the world. So obviously, I never really knew I knew that I was a little good at everything, you know.
Uh-huh.
But and so I knew that if I focus on surfing, I'll get better and better and better.
Well, I remember when we did the interview with you back then. I don't remember if we did actually interview, if we asked you a question or we just filmed you. But I remember that you both were standing out completely from all the crowd, all the people that we have filmed or did a documentary about. It was these two kids, these two young guns, super energetic, super positive, surfing, looking even different than other people. What made you so different back then? Would you remember
we were like a group of like 6, 7.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, 7 like blonde kid that used to go like from 8 feet in the water every weekend or every afternoon or Wednesday afternoon from like on the weekend from 8 to 6. We were sunburned. Like teacher told our parents like, can you take them home earlier on Sunday because we couldn't open our eyes on Monday at school. We're all sunburned, all blonde kid. And we just, it was our crew and we were doing our thing and we didn't care about anyone else, you know, anyone else. Like we just surfed and we were like playing soccer with friends, but it was just our crew, you know, like we just did everything together. It was like a group of like 6 or 7 of us.
Mm.
But then we had like Lou too. Lou was like good at surfing, one of our best friends. And then Samir, Ramsey's brother, was very good too. And then it was Ramsey and I. And then I think that Ramsey and I never really get competitive between us, but the people around us make us competitive or think that we were competitive and trying to make something that never have existed, you know? And so we were mature enough to look it like from far, like, you know, have a look at it and be like, yeah, like, you know, we don't care about like the people.
Mm.
And then Ramsey gave me so much confidence, like to me, like, I don't know, like back in the day, I remember when we were surfing and there was like this French kid and I was like, whoa, he rips. He's like, no, he doesn't. Like, we're better. Like, fuck. It's not because he's like, I remember Nathan Curran, like Tom Curran's son, we were good friend with. He was sponsored by Quicksilver. And then he has this weird style, but I was like, oh, like, he rips. He's like, no, he doesn't. We'll smoke him, you know? And he never got like impressed by anyone. I was like, all right. I was like 12. And then I took this. I was like, oh, this is smart. This, like,
this thinking.
Yeah, like.
This way of thinking,
yeah,
right? This
Ramsey
mindset.
Was just like, whoever it is, I don't give one or two shit, you know. He was always like this. So I was like, yeah, you know, like
you don't get intimidated by other people.
No.
You just keep on
so
doing.
We just
you're
came.
Also
we
are
the kids from Morocco who came and like, okay, we're here. We're loud at the contest. We have our friend. We're like doing good, and then nothing can stop us. And we're coming from the same little town, you know, so we had these inside jokes and all those little things. And, you know, we grew up in the French, like, we went to French school in Morocco, in a Muslim country, which is, like, different. So we knew how they think in France, you know, and we knew that it was okay to think differently and be happy. So we had this thing, you know, this, intelligence, emotional intelligence. And so we really were taking over, seriously. Like, to be honest, when we were a kid, like, we were just like the kid from Morocco that comes every summer in France and do contest. And then we moved to France, and then it was very good for us because the surf industry is bigger there. And we just, like, we were kind of, yeah, like you say, unique in terms, like we could speak like two languages already.
Mm. How did the other kids feel about you?
Oh, we just made them laugh a lot because we are just very funny, I think.
Yeah.
But it was always we never had any trouble. We always had friends. We were just like, you know. But at the same time, that people were knew that if they did something, we won't miss them in terms of jokes. You know, we were ready to like, as I say, we were not impressed
by anyone.
They basically
liked you, but they liked you. They were not like they didn't see you as a threat.
Mm.
Taking over their sponsors or their competitions and so on.
No, because we're still Moroccan and considered as Moroccan. And Morocco is so close to Europe, so the sponsors for us were in Europe. But they always see us as the two Moroccan, and everybody goes to Morocco in the winter, so they know we have good waves. So we are always like, oh, the kid from there, we have friends coming over every holidays. Mm. And it was just very nice. They never see us as a treat. Like, obviously, they saw us like as a treat in the contest. Mm. For sure we got some jealousy. For sure they were like, oh, why is he Moroccan and he's training with a French team and my son is not, for example, you know? And he's French, yeah, but your son is not good in school and maybe he's not as good in the water, I don't know. Mm. But yeah, I always like be protected by my parents about that, you know?
Was there any pressure back then that you can remember, like any sort of pressure that you have to make it or that you have to live up to the standards that you have set for yourself, something like that?
So, like, I was definitely like, when I got there, they were all like, oh my God, you come from Morocco, you're not going to spend the winter here, you'll see the winter. And it was like my first year, I was 15, I was like, all right, you know what? You guys using boots and a 4-3, I'm going to use just boots and a 3-2 in the winter to just make you shut your mouth. And I did it. Right. You know, I was just like that. And then, of course, there was some pressure, but I was just like strong enough in my head to be like, you know, if you tell me I can do something, I'll do it. Mm-hmm. And Ramsey was in France too. So we were together, like, as soon as I called, he was in normal school, I was in boarding school with a French team to train, but I just text him every day where we were going surfing. So he was coming to surf with me. And the guy were like, they were like, stop texting him, because he was way better than anyone, but he never wanted to surf for France. And they asked him, if you want to come to the boarding school, you got to surf for France. And Ramsey was like, I will never. I'd rather stop school. And that's what he did. So it was very different because me, they never see me as one of the best in the world competing. So it was just like, okay, like he probably will do something in surfing, but not as big as Ramsey. And then Ramsey was like, very good, and he was like, you know, like, to be honest, he was like, fuck them all. He always told me, like, I don't give a fuck, like, seriously. He always shit on everyone's head, like, I don't care, I'm doing my thing. And he knew he was good, and he's the best of all of them that were with me in boarding school, you know. But we always had, it was different for him, but for me, I always been like down low, like, okay, I'm okay, I just want to have my diploma and surf every day. But in the back of my head, like, I just want to improve as much as I can and, you know, be the best of them all.
You're more like the quiet planner, the quiet strategic planner, yeah. Planning everything in the back and...
Yeah, just for me.
Keeping it quiet, but in the same time, working your thing
step by step. Wanted to do good, but I didn't want to... I knew I had to work harder than anyone because I feel like I had this little talent, but not as talented as some of the kids I was with. But at the same time, I knew that I was good in good wave, I was good in big wave, and then I had like a good feeling with the ocean as well. And I always see myself, you know, as a bad surfer, I was, when I was a kid, I couldn't even see myself on camera. I was like, oh, that's so ugly. And people were laughing. I was giving myself shit on when we were watching the footage every day. I was like, oh my God, that's so ugly. All that turn. Like, I was always like, never liked my surfing until like 20 years old. I hate to see myself surfing.
And so when did the shift happen? You said 20 years old. What happened at 20 years old?
At 19 years old, actually. At 19 years old, I almost quit surfing. I was like, oh, I'm over it. I was in Bordeaux.
Studying. Were you bored, or why were you over it?
I was like, just, I discovered like the girls and the parties, and I was in college in Bordeaux. So I was like, whoa, now I'm in college. I won't surf anymore. When you do college, you're done for your career. And then I wanted to be a physio, and then I realized I didn't want to be touched by people, and I didn't want to touch random people. So I quit. And then I went back to Morocco, and I didn't surf for like a month. And then I went to surf again with Romain Lollet and PV Laborde and Michael Darrigade as a filmer. That was the first trip of Michael Darrigade, who now works with me a lot. And I just surfed again. I was surfing better than when I stopped, you know, after a 6-month break. And I was like, oh my God, there's something. And then as I wasn't going to college, I went to France. And I spent a month in France to surf because the waves were good. And
something happened back then.
Yeah. And then I went to Desert Point in April 2012 for a swell. And I scored a swell. And boom, it clicked. I was like, okay, whoa, there's something to do. You know, we can go chase swell and do good. And I came back from there. And we went to Galicia with Jerome Sirin and Ashi Munyan. They took me there for a big wave session. And I got pounded 3 times. And I was like, whoa. Okay, it was very big, and I can handle that, and I love that. I love the pounding. I love the big wave. Whoa. And then next thing you know, I came back here for the summer, and I just scored and did an edit by myself. I was back with Rip Curl right away. As soon as I could do these 2 trip, Rip Curl took me back because I lost my sponsor at 19. And then...
Okay, so at 19, you were having some questions back in
18,
mind.
At 18, I lost my sponsor.
You lost your sponsor, and then you decided to stop. You took some time off. And then when you came back stronger because you saw that there was opportunities and fun in other things. Did you know what you were pursuing back then?
No, not really. It just came like step by step. I just like chased some slab, surf, like do some edit. I went back with Rip Curl, and I was like, yeah, I want to go to Indo. And instead of doing the Pro Junior, because the Pro Junior back then it was under 20. I want to go to Indo and score and make an edit. So they're like, okay, we have a house in Uluwatu Surf Villa. You can go and stay there. And I went there, and I just surf every day, get some footage, make an edit. And from this edit, it got shared. And then from there, I came back here in October for another swell. But I was in college in France, in a marketing college. Like, I was studying marketing. So from there, I went to see the director. I was like, okay, listen, I'm half pro surfer, and then I need to surf too because they pay me some trip. And they're like, okay, if that's kind of your job, you can do that, but you have to be good at school. I was like, yeah, if you let me go on some trip, I'll be very good at school because, you know, you do what you love. So you come back and you see how lucky you are when all your friends are sitting on, you know, sitting there and you just came from Tahiti or like Indo or whatever. So then I went on this Java trip and I got all the footage again. Like I got some, and I did the edit again, and it went just to 15,000 views, but at the time it was pretty good for young Euro, like North African surfer. And then January 2013, I went to Nazaré.
And wow, I was 19. That was the first time in Nazaré. Yeah, that I remember one.
I think I was 19 by then.
How was it, by the way, to watch your footage this time? You, when you did the editing, because you said in the beginning when you looked at yourself, you had a very critical point about yourself. But how was it when you were looking at it?
After that 6-month break,
yeah,
as my surf was way better.
So your surf changed, or your vision that changed about yourself?
No, my surfing.
Your surfing changed.
I stopped surfing. Mm.
Did you train differently? What happened?
Nothing. I just stopped. I just stopped for 6 months. Mm. And I went back out, and I was just like, I was surfing with no pressure anymore. I didn't want to be the best. I almost quit surfing, so it was just like, okay, just let's see, you know? Like, it wasn't like, I don't know how.
I think you're saying something very interesting there. Like, the moment you dropped the pressure from trying to become something,
yeah,
then everything started changing, also flowing. Yeah, I got it. Okay, so Nazaré?
And then Nazaré, yeah, I remember I was, again, like, I was at home having dinner with some friend and Jerome, because I traveled with Jerome for a few years before taking my own path. And his partner was calling him, and he's like, wow, I need you in Nazaré. And Jerome was like, I don't want to go. And then I was like, I don't want to go to Nazaré. Like, you know, fuck that place. And then he's like, no, I need you. Everybody's bailing on me. I need you, and I need Altman to come drive the second ski. Because back in the day, in Nazaré, you had to go out with two skis. And then he's like, okay, I'm going. And then he's like, you're coming. I was like, what? I was like, okay, I'm coming. And then we went from my house straight to the airport. And then my mom was like, where are you going? And I'm like, mom, I'm going to Nazaré. This is the end of my life or the beginning of my career. And I left home.
Did she know what it was?
No, but then I surfed for 2 days. We came back and it just went boom. You know, like all the media, all the stuff, and like boom. And my mom, it was, so the swell was like probably Monday, Tuesday. We came back on Wednesday. And the video got out on Sunday. And I was surfing at Anchor Point. And I came home and my mom was just crying. And she just saw the video. And she was like, what? Because it was like, nobody surfed Nazaré back in the day. Like you said, like, it was the session when Garrett got the New York Times cover. It was just us. We were like, you know, a few people.
And you were the first Moroccans doing that.
I was the first Moroccan. I was the youngest to surf there. I didn't realize like how important in terms of marketing it could be. I could have done a way, you know.
But hold on, you're missing a lot of things. We're missing a lot of things there. Did you have any training? Did you have any preparation?
Yeah,
to
was good
there?
Yeah, I was a surfer, you know, and I've been like surfing bigger waves than anyone on my age since I'm 12. I was the one who goes big in everything.
So your training was only about that, like just surfing, or
was
there
was
something
just surfing,
else?
You know, when you know, like it was just about surfing. But I remember that I never panicked, never ever, because like when I was younger, my dad is claustrophobe, you know. Oops. My dad is claustrophobe, so...
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he didn't want me to be like him. You know, as a parent, I think you always want the best for your kid, and you don't want them to do the same mistake or have the same issues. So I used to play with him, like, soccer before bed with this, like, foamy ball, and then we jumped on bed, and he used to put a pillow on my head, you know, but for not very, like, gently. But I was just like, oh, no, no. And my mom was like, stop it. He's like, no, no, no. And then he said, stay calm. Stay calm. And I don't know, like... After a few days, like, I stayed calm. I was like, whoa, you can save so much energy. I was like, just squish me, you know, like, no problem.
Training started early.
And then, so I had this in my head at a young age that I was told, like, when you don't panic, you handle things away, you know, more. But, yeah, I went to Nazaré, and then the first big day I didn't surf. It was too big. We lost the tow board. Garrett McNamara was like, I'm not towing you. I'm going to keep you safe for your mom. You're too young. And I was like, okay, like, you know, I was really pissed. And then the next day I thought it was still huge. And I got two or three waves. And I was like going almost deeper than Jerome and Ashi. Seriously, like on the footage, and the cameraman was like, hey, the kid is deeper than you, blah, blah, blah. And I was like super proud, you know, but that's what I wanted because I saw footage the night before. I was like, oh, those guys are on the shoulder, kinda, you know, like, I don't wanna, like, I already wanted to always do something more, something special. Okay, this is not because it's my first Nazaré. I want to show that I'm.
Then there you go. The competitive mindset came back.
I was like, you know what? I want to be the best at this because I know I had it in me and I know there's something to do with it. And this is where I'm going to, you know, like enjoy myself. And at the same time, I don't know, you know, like just be happy, but be good at it and make me, you know, like maybe feel my ego. I don't know. Like, I have no idea, like, but I just had this feeling that it was something I really love and I was good at. I had a feeling and I just pursued. And then I went to Chopo, I got some bombs, towing in, luckily. And I came back to Indo and I did some video and just like boom, boom, boom. And I always wanted more and more and more and more. And I always like, you know, trying to find new sponsors and different things to do and watching what people do through internet and like reading all the stuff by Big Wave. And then I did one trip in Morocco with Mark Healy, Greg Long, Jan Walsh and Alex Gray that changed my life and my vision of surfing. I was with the best and they were like, okay, like this kid is something.
What have changed then? Tell me about that vision. How did it became? If you can develop a little bit about how that trip changed your life or your vision about surfing.
I was with the best big wave surfer in the world, and I was just like...
What did you pick from them?
Everything they say. I was asking them questions, and I remember sitting with Mark Healy in the car, watching this lab and asking him questions. He took time to give me advices. So everything that Healy told me on that trip was stuck in my mind still till now. And then I saw Greg Long preparation, checking his leash, his fins, his board, the ski. I'm like, okay. I took this from Greg Long. And then I saw how like Alex Gray was taking it more funny, you know, to keep it funny. And then even if he was stressed, he was always making a joke on the boat when we were heading surfing Big Wave. And I just, we surfed Big Wave for like 3 weeks straight in Morocco. It was nonstop swell. And I was like, wow, I'm with the best guy and I'm taking wave with them. And they like, they let me a big board. They give me a big board and stuff, you know, and they keep in touch with me. And Healy was like, if you come to Hawaii, you can stay with me. And Greg was like, if you need anything in Cali. And I went to Mexico and I needed some help and he helped me out. And I was like, whoa, if those people are helping me, I know they're nice, but it's probably that I have a chance to do something, you know? And then May.
You saw the opportunity there.
Yeah. Yeah. And May 2015, Healy got the biggest one in Puerto, but I got a wave too and almost drowned. And then I was like, this is what I wanted. I wanted to have a big wave out in Big Wave to see, you know, to have it. And this was another step. Okay, I'm on one of the big wave, biggest session ever in Puerto, and I ate the biggest one on the head. My vest exploded, my Patagonia filled up with water. I almost drowned. There's Healy and Garrett crying almost on the beach, and Tom Lowe running, and they couldn't do stuff, like anything for me. And I handled it, you know. And the next day, I went back out, and I got a big one, and I fell again.
You went back the next day?
The next day without vest.
Hold on a second there. How did you manage that? How did you handle that fear? This is very important for
the
people.
To be honest, I didn't realize I almost drowned.
You didn't realize that?
No, I didn't realize because I was like, I had this training,
yeah,
apnea training just before, in September 2014 here.
Oh, let's talk about that, like all the trainings that you have been going through. I think you also mentioned to me once that you have been doing some mental training as well with somebody from Middle East or something like that.
Yeah. From he lives on the middle in the Middle East, Scott Stevenson, but he's a British.
Mm-hmm.
And he just came to you know, to do a little un bilan, like
a check, you know, like
a check. And yeah, we just, he did his thing, and at the end he's like, "Wow, I've been with some like great tennis man, and you're in the same state of mind that those guys after I checked them." Mm. But before,
what did he teach you?
Nothing. Mm. Nothing that I didn't know. Mm. I was just telling him how I was preparing myself mentally and how I see life and how I see things, and he's like, yeah, like
good. Yeah. Check.
Yeah, because I'm like, my mom is a life coach, you know, and she's like a psychologist, and she read all the books. Like, she's like a psychologist. She read all the books since I'm a kid, and she's a life coach. But I think she always gave me that self-confidence that I have, mm-hmm, and it gave me a lot of love. So I was always like very mature for my age. Besides that, I could like read people too and see like, oh, you know, like also I think it comes from my mom, you know, and I've always been like psychologist, like this is weird and this is bullshit, you know, like I don't want to talk with the random. I've always been like that. I don't want to talk with the random. Now that I'm more mature, I understand when people go there, because there's things that you better talk with some random, you know. Yeah. But I've always been like blah blah blah, and my mom was laughing because she was my psychologist actually, you know, probably, and my life coach, you know, so
that's nice.
I've always been like.
So do you, when you've been doing your training, you said, so you did apnea training, holding breath.
Then was in Scott Stevenson. I saw him in July 2015, but in September 2014, I did a training with Dwayne Fizimons from the Gold Coast here in Bali for 2 weeks. And then he helped me a lot, because he helped me to see that when you think you don't have any more power underwater with no air, you still have a little bit. And that's what saved me in May 2015, when I almost drowned.
In Mexico.
Yeah. Mm. And I was thinking about that the whole time. I was like, oh, you still have some. And I was just making it out before every wave, one breath. Mm. And then I remember telling Coco Nogales, who was the only guy with the ski, that I was like, two waves and I'm gone. I'm going to pass out, like, or I'm going to drink water. And he got me just before and took me out, and the ski broke down. And then it was super gnarly. And then he was like, ta-ta-ta-ta. The ski was just like working a little bit, and he put me in the harbor. I jumped from the ski in the harbor, and I almost drowned with no wave in like 1 foot, like, because I had no power.
No energy anymore.
No energy, no more, like, I was like, very like low on power. And
so yeah, I follow what your stories right before your contest and not contest, like I mean like the events that you go to. I see you training a lot of conditioning, cardio, strength. Can you tell us about that a little bit?
Yeah, last year for the last 2 years I've been doing CrossFit a lot. So from like October to like April.
Where do you do that?
I do CrossFit, for example, because...
Where?
I do it in Agadir. Uh-huh. And so I do CrossFit in Agadir.
That's your home base, right?
Yeah. There were a box there, a CrossFit box. And I always trained, you know, because I was in boarding school with a French team. So I knew that training was important. I was like having twice a week, like physical training. And I saw Shane Dorian doing this through social media. I was like, whoa, Shane is doing CrossFit. There's a CrossFit box. Let's try. And I tried and I was like, I enjoyed it. And then I became almost addicted to it. I was like, oh, this is very good. And then if I don't train doing CrossFit for a long time, I just feel like I'm not ready to surf big waves. So it became like, okay, this is what I need to be confident. And then I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing, but at the same time, it's a good thing, I'm sure, because it makes me healthy. And then I'm sure that when you're healthy, your mind is healthier and you can...
For sure, it's all interconnected.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So I stick to that for three years, and now I changed it. I just do 3 times a week because I'm a surfer, I'm not a CrossFit man.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And I just think that it's very hard on the body, so I just do a lot of like musculation and like 3 times a week and 3 times a week like just CrossFit. And I don't surf as much as I should, you know, in Morocco. I just try to train and go on swell and be ready every time it's big. So it just became a part of my life, like, to train. And then I remember, like, I was seeing all those guys sharing the things on social media about their training, and I never done it before. And people was like, why? I was like, because people don't need to know what I'm doing to be ready when it's big. They're just my sponsor. They just need to see me and the people, when it's big, getting the bomb. They don't need to know what's behind. And I always been thinking like that. Like, no matter how you reach your goal, it's your thing. If you wanna work from 8 to 6 Monday to Wednesday, because you have something to give on Friday, or you wanna do it Thursday night, that's your fucking problem. But you have to, you know, you just have to do it, and you have to give like to the people what they want, or your sponsors, or your bosses, or yourself, you know. So then it became different when I started to have like really sponsor, and I had to promote a lifestyle, and I was like, whoa, you know what, people are always asking me how do that, and I was tired of answering them. So I was like, okay, like if I do this on social media, they won't ask me anymore, you know, they'll see like my preparation and they'll see it, you know. And
well, did it add value for you to do that? Was it good to do it, to be more public about your trainings, what are you doing?
No, I didn't care.
You didn't care much?
No, I didn't care. I can like, I enjoy social media, but at the same time,
it's not necessary.
No, it's because I have to do it.
Yeah, I see.
You know?
But what about mental training? Do you do visualization regularly? Meditation or something like that?
I used to do visualization every night for like since 14 to like 24. Yeah. And the last 2 years I've been just choosing sometimes I feel like right now in Bali, I'm here for a week to see my girlfriend and I haven't done it. I'm just like, you know, I just flew from Nazaré to here.
Yeah.
And I just had a 60-foot breaking on my face like 5 days ago.
Oh yeah, I saw the footage.
Yes,
I was amazing actually.
I got pounded.
And yeah, you are now on the WSL Big Wave Challenge.
Yeah,
something right? Like the video you shared with me. Tell me about that.
I just got nominated like for a ride of the year on a big one towing in. I was super happy. You know, I'd say on the big one because when you tow, you don't know what you're going into. And then I also got nominated for paddling wave in Nazaré. So I think it's going to help me to get in the contest next year, probably for the Nazaré Challenge. And then I'll have that was my goal for like 3 years, 4 years to be on the Big Wave Tour. And I'm like, you know, almost reaching it, and I'm close to it. And it just makes me want to work harder, you know, instead of like waiting and be like, I just want more and more and more and more and more to make sure to don't let anyone the choice, but to put me in this contest and to get the spot I will deserve, because I don't say I deserve. When I see everyone on the list, I'm like, who I'm going to take the spot of? even though I can't say who, because there's guys in the country that don't never paddle there. No, I don't care. I'm doing my thing. When my time will come, it will come, and I'll do good. You don't need to force things in big wave surfing. Big wave surfing is like a marathon. It's not a race. You know, the more older you get, the more experience, and experience is priceless. And you know, I learn every session something, and now I go there thinking I don't know shit. When I was 20, I went there knowing, telling I know everything. Now it all changed, and I think it's just maturity is natural for the human being, especially men, to start to be mature at 25. Like, I still don't know myself now. I think I'll know it maybe a little more in 10 years. Seriously.
When we're 20, we have a total different dialogue for sure.
Yeah, totally different, you know. But it's good to realize that and to speak about it, you know. It's good to say, yeah, I was a little shit, you know. And yeah. And I've always been respectful, I think, and very nice to everyone, because this is how I like, and this is how I want to be remembered, as a polite and nice guy and funny person.
And you know everyone, like every single person that I go on Instagram and I like or follow or something, I see followed by Ottoman Shufani or liked by Ottoman Shufani.
So yeah.
How do you do that? Like, you're quite a social person, and I believe also you travel everywhere, so you meet people from all places.
Yeah, you know, I try to give time to people. So when people, I'm like, hey, how are you doing? And they answer me. You know, I listen to them. And I think that people see this, and I'm interested into people. When I think the best thing in the world is people, you know. I feel so rich knowing people and with different cultures, and having friends all around the world is what I live for. I love to go and stay with the boys from there. I'm just like, okay, this is how they live. In Morocco, we didn't live like that. So when you go to Tahiti, it's different. Like the boys, they go fish at a young age and do sashimi after the session, and then they don't have a car, they have skis, because you know they like. And then I think that this makes me realize that the world is a beautiful place, and then you know you get richer by knowing the people and knowing the culture of this world, because this is our world, this is planet Earth, this is our home, the whole world. Like, I don't feel like I'm coming from this place, or I just grew up there, so it makes me who I am. But I have so much more to get by going in outside of my comfort zone, you know? And social media is good for that, but it's true that, like, people always telling me, like, I like everything, and, like, I'm followed by some, like, they say, oh, how do you know this person, or how?
Yeah,
like,
that's
yeah, I was
I
just at the airport in LA, and then she looked at me, she's like, oh, are you from Morocco? I was like, yeah, oh, I'm friend of this, and I saw you, and I was like, oh, and then I socialized with her or him, and then I just...
How many trips you have per year?
Oh, I went to Nazaré 5 times this winter, then I would usually go to Mexico once, and Tahiti once every 2 years. And
Jaws.
And then Jaws, Mavericks, 1 or 2 a winter. So okay. About 10 trips.
So basically, like on average, 1 time a month you're somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
So what do you do in between? Okay, there's training, of course. There is, you mentioned girlfriend, by the way, right? Like, it's a new girlfriend.
Yeah, I just, yeah. So yeah, for like 4 years, I was fully single, and I was like, yeah, I don't want a girlfriend, because...
Don't want a relationship.
The reason I didn't want a girlfriend is simple, is that a girlfriend or a boyfriend, like for a girl, like whatever, I'm open-minded about that, is something you can't control. The feeling of someone is something you can't control. When you're feeling something, you're controlled. So I was like, imagine if like I'm going to Mavs, for example, and it's my girlfriend's birthday. I would never, ever... like miss a swell for anyone's birthday, or if I don't care, because this is what makes me happy, is what I live for. And then imagine going on a plane knowing that the person you love is feeling bad because you're going, and then it's going to go through your mind. And then I was like, yeah, I want to protect myself from that, you know. But then everybody was like, my dad, my friend, like, yeah, he's going to come to you, and you won't see it coming, and this is what happened. And I was like, yeah, but I know it will happen, but I don't know when, of course. And the thing is that, like, she really understands what I'm doing, and
supportive.
Yeah, and it just, yeah, it's a new thing. And my, you know, like, once again, I thought I knew everything. I don't know shit, because now I'm like in love, and I'm just like, yeah, this is sick, you know. When like 2 months ago, I would never say that. You never hear me say that, you know.
Oh, nice, man! Congratulations, then.
Thanks.
So you're traveling a lot, you have a girlfriend. So what else are you doing in between? Like, you, who are you outside of contests? Who are you outside of the surfing? Like, do you think surfing is your identity, or you have another identity?
For most people, like, I'm the for most people, I'll hate when they say that, but I'm a crazy big wave surfer, you know. But for my close friend, I'm just a good friend to talk with and have fun with, and to ask advice sometimes about life, because I'm only child, so I don't have brother and sister. But so my close friend, they're like brothers or sister to me, you know. And I'm just like a friend that they can like call when they don't feel good, because I'm good at giving advice and I'm talking to people, and I'm very bad at applying them myself. But yeah, I don't know. And at the same time, yeah, I'm a guy who loves to have fun. And to party and to enjoy life and to make most of life and live it to the fullest. And it's connected to big wave surfing as well, because I'm pushing myself very hard. Surfing these waves is something that I know it's not normal, but what is normal?
Is the norm, right?
What is the norm? Mm. There's no norm. When people tell me you're crazy, I'm like, yeah, tell me what's normal then. And then I'll tell you if I'm crazy or not. Mm. So, you know. But yeah, I think like if you go through my social media and you can very, it's me, like it's between big wave, having fun and some words and giving props to the people who deserve it always. And yeah, I try to be like what you see on my Instagram and stuff, all the jokes is what I am, you know. So I'm not very different from it, but people are different. You have to make the difference through social media, you know. And people, they always
sometimes it's not authentic, right?
Yeah, but the thing is that it's like people are saying, yeah, I met this guy one of my friends, his social media is so lame, like he's always like contracting and showing his abs and stuff. I'm like, yeah, but this is what you have to be smart enough to see that there's a difference, you know. People are awesome, but they're doing this on social media because it's different, and you have to accept the difference, you know. You have to accept it that this guy can be this on your phone screen and this in real life, and what counts is real life, you know. So I'm really the same as my thing, you know. That's what I do. I'm not photoshopping my surfing photo, and I like to make jokes and give shit to people like for fun, but. But I realized that there's a difference, and for I was sure. trying to tell people this. And
yeah, for sure.
And then I always try to see the goods in everything. Look, before social media, people's like, yeah, social media, blah, blah, always complaining, but they're all using it. Okay, before, back in the day, if you wanted to make a career in music, you had to know this guy from the studio or fucking lick this guy's feet to get to your job, you know? To the point you want. Now you take a guitar, you sing, you put it on YouTube. If you're a good man, you can get famous, and people will get famous in terms of your musical stuff. I'm not taking like, and people will hear your music. So social media is good. You just have to Instagram.
A little bit the same, right? If you show real content, if you show real stuff.
If you're smart and if you
self promote yourself, you don't need to have lick somebody's people.
So I see this as good. Everything has a good part and a bad part, but I always try to see the good part of it, because we won't, for example, I'm talking a lot about social media, but it won't go away, you know? So you have to accept
it's just going
to
get worse.
Yeah.
it's going to be a part of it. Okay. Let's look a little bit back again. Just go back quickly to how you created everything. Like now today, we are in Bali. We're talking about the past. We're talking about where you are at today. If we want to summarize a little bit and have it like condensed, packed advice for young athletes, it can be in tennis, it can be in soccer, it can be anything. What would be the key points that they should not miss to get to where they are at? To get to the next level, for example.
They should doing it for themselves, first of all, and believe in their dream. So if it doesn't work, they have no regret. There will be no problem. But if they didn't go as big as they should because of some people or because whatever reason, they will have regret and they'll have issues in their life, I think. So it's very important for me to just try your best and see what happened. So take out the pressure, but still do your best, you know? It's a hard thing to find, but I never wanted to have regrets in my life, never. And I have like a couple regrets, is the wave I missed, but that's it, you know.
How to take out the pressure? What's your best advice on taking out the pressure? How would you do it for yourself to take out the pressure when the pressure is there? Is it like, do you talk yourself out of it? What do you do?
Yeah, I'm just like, so before a big wave session, you'll see me, I'm just like laughing and you know, the work has been done before, and it's not now that I will train, it's not an hour before, so I know that the work has been done, and I was just like, okay, let's just like take the pressure by, maybe I'm just laughing and having fun and then making jokes and talking a lot, you know, and being super, like just letting every emotion goes. I don't think about what they're going to think about me or what should I say, or there's a camera there. I'm just like me, just like, okay, now my material is ready, my boards are ready. I'm just going to surf big wave, and then I'm going to do what I love the most. So I'm just going to, it's just being me, you know, like just.
It sounds like you have a ritual, like, yeah, checking your equipment, preparing yourself way before, of course, all these weeks or something of training. Yeah. And then just right before getting in the water, you take out the pressure by being optimistic, by being funny, by talking, right? Okay, that's a good process. Like, yeah, sometimes I recommend that to my clients. Tell them, okay, you need to have your ritual. Like Rafael Nadal, he has his own ritual, you know, like he's a little bit OCD, doing this in his nose and taking his
me
socks.
Me, I'm like, I prepare my material the night before. I check on everything the night before, because this is what I saw.
Why the night before, not in the morning?
Because in the morning, I try it in the morning, and you get late. It's always something happens. So I've seen Greg Long preparing himself the night before, and I know he's the best.
And I think it's for a good reason they do it in the night before.
Yeah.
Because you minimize decisions in the morning. Yeah. In the morning, you just want to wake up.
What I do
fresh.
In the morning in Nazaré, I woke up at 6. I put my wetsuit on, my car put my board in my car, and they always know me as the guy who put the board and let it's a 10-4, you know, so I can
huge
put, yeah, it's a huge, so I have the back of my have the trunk open, so they know it's me coming to the harbor. I put my favorite music, like Linkin Park, just my favorite music to get motivated, of like Pennywise or some like hard rock, and I'm with my wetsuit hoodie on, and this is, you know, it's game day, you know, it's boom, it's here, we gotta go. And I just have my material ready, so I have nothing else to do, just put on my wetsuit and go.
Nice. So
that's
your
my routine. Yeah.
That's your process. Very good.
And I just want to stay hydrated, and just I eat a banana sometimes. But
do you think anyone can get and become a high level athlete if they want to? Because you mentioned something before about talent. Kids were more talented. What do you think about talent versus hard work?
Talent sucks. You can be the most talented guy, if you don't work hard, you're fucked now.
To be honest, you're fucked, man.
I've seen guys that were not talented, man, but they were the hard worker. And I've seen guys that were talented, but they were lazy, because talent makes you lazy, to be honest. So I'd rather be a hard worker than a talented kid, seriously. Hard work always win. Always win.
Very nice. All right, we're getting close to this one, and it has been a big pleasure. I just want to ask you a couple of more questions. What's coming up for you? So for people that are listening, to be able to follow whatever is coming up next, like, is there a big contest coming, or an adventure maybe that you're going to be going to?
Yeah, I want to thank those people who will listen, because like, I feel really honored to be listened by people. Like, it feels very special, and I hope they enjoy what I say.
Oh, for sure. There's a lot of
lessons
to take there.
You know, now I'm going to be like, whoa, what did I say? Like, you know, like, there's this little, like, thing. But I'm going back to Morocco on Saturday or on Sunday. I might change my ticket, but to make a surprise to my girlfriend, to stay one more day with her.
So why are you in Bali, by the way? Are you here to prepare for something,
no,
or just
no,
for
just
time
here,
off?
I'm just here to see my girlfriend for a week, because I did good in Nazaré. I could take a week off. I had one of my best friend, Ty's birthday today, so it was a good time to come, and I was like, okay, still the season is still not over, so I'm just gonna go to Nazaré and go to Bali and train, and then go home this weekend, and then as soon as there Nazaré, well, I'll go back there until the end of the season, and then I'll figure it out. Maybe I'll get the biggest of the year. It's not done yet, you know, but my goal is to have another big wave towing in and not big wave paddling.
What's coming up for you for the next couple of years? Like, what is all this going to? What do you want?
I want to be on the big wave tour, and I want to be big wave tour world champ. I want to be world champ.
There you go. That's clear and precise and very well articulated.
Yeah, and you know, it's like, I don't think it's impossible, because nothing is impossible. And I just think that I just have to work harder and harder and harder and harder, and I'll reach my goal. And now I just start to find my balance a little more, and I'm just ready to you know, put my head down and work as hard as I can for the whole year. Because usually I train and I come here for 3 months and I just surf and I get caught in the party and the parties, and I go back in September and it's a whole new start. So this year I just want to be full on. And I'm sure it will work, but I'll see how it works. But of course, when you work hard, you know, I had it. It happened to me, I've seen it. When I work hard, it pays off.
You see results.
All the time. So when you see results, you're like, okay, so why should I stop working hard if I want to reach my goal? And as I say, I don't want any regret. So now I realize that, whoa, you know, the train is here. I'm on the train, but I can't miss it easily. You know, I like to think that I'm bad. You know, I like to think that I'm not there at all. But then I've seen things, like I got nominated, everyone's happy, but for me it's nothing. I'm not happy with this. Yeah. I don't get like satisfied by this. I'll never get satisfied.
This made me think of two more questions. Sorry to hold you back a little bit longer. So what is it that, what do you struggle with when it comes to like the personal challenges? Like you say, like you need to work harder and harder, harder. Does it mean like you struggle from, I don't know, procrastination, for example, or what is the struggle? Discipline, something like that, or?
No, it's just that I'm alone in Morocco doing this. Yeah. There's nobody that understands what I'm doing.
Yeah.
There's no one to coach me, pretty much. I have to be my own coach, mentally, my own physical coach. Luckily, I grew up in France in boarding school with a French team, so I had a good base, and I could really took from this. But then you grow, and then there's like all the things that comes with life, you know, the financial pressure, the love, the all the stuff. So it's just finding my balance, but my real balance, because before my balance was 6 months training, 6 months not training. And I think that, and I knew it's not what we call balance, you know. So yeah, just trying to find this real balance and being peace with myself, you know, because I know that when I'm partying sometimes, I don't even enjoy it. I know that, fuck no, but in 1 month I got to train again, and then there's Nazare season coming, and then, you know, so I don't want to go in this state of mind. I just want to, you know.
Consistency,
yeah.
Yeah. And the last question was, what would happen and how would you feel if you reached this goal of being in the big tour? Why would you want to do that?
There's two reasons. Yeah. There's the reason because all my friends are there, and I know I have my place there between them. I know. And second of all, for make my country proud, you know, like that'd be sick for the kids who wanna be pro surfing in Morocco. It'll help them if you have Ramsey on the city and I'm on the big wave tour. Fuck, there's two kids from this small town in Morocco that are the top level of surfing, you know, in both category. That'll be awesome, like fucking sick. You know?
That's really really awesome. That's really good. Like, I think we should end on this note because this is really nice. And thank you so much again for making time for this.
Thanks for having me.
We tried to connect, I think, for five times, six times, every time something happening, both from our side. So yeah, I will definitely share some links from whatever things you want me to share, like your Instagram, obviously, for people to follow you. Also, from some people that you have mentioned that you'd like people to get to know, like maybe Ramsey or whoever, people that you trained with. And yes, also the video. Can I share the video you sent me the other day also?
Of course.
Sure. Excellent.
Of course. Thanks a lot for having me. I hope I can inspire people to do their best and reach their goal and live their dream life.
For sure they would do.
And nothing but love.
Excellent. Thank you.